Thank you once again for coming out, for being a part of the worship service here at Kwamba Baptist. And we, as you know, we have been working our way through the book of Acts. We are currently at Acts 14:24, and we'll be following through to verse 28. The passage last week, Acts 14:19-23, we addressed the matter of the qualities of kingdom people, and they're marked by courage and perseverance. We discussed these points last week. Courage and perseverance are the marks of kingdom people, and that's where we come down. And in these days of very peculiar things going on, falsehoods abounding across this nation and even around the world, strange things happening. We don't lose heart. We gain heart, and we desire what God would have us to do. So we want to look at verses 24 through 28 and focus on this theme. It's the work of God and mission evangelism. This evangelism, the missions and local evangelism, are fundamental. They're the fundamental task of the church taken together. They are fundamental. Without these, all we are is just a loose-fitting association, and we might as well make ourselves into a 7-Eleven store or something like that. But we are the Church of God, the called out ones. So today we're going to focus on that theme, the work of God in mission evangelism. And we trust that the Lord would come by the power of the Holy Spirit, overcoming the weakness of this person before you today and bringing the message of truth to you and to me. We want to recall one verse before we pray. If you'll turn to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. A little context, we begin with verse 6. So when they had come together, that is the crowd of disciples, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Now, these are the words of Jesus just prior to his ascension. They are vital for the church to attend to. They attended in the first context, and we must attend in this context. The Great Commission to go from this place and increasing rings outward in many different ways to glorify God and benefit the church and ingather souls. Remember Acts 1:8, vital passage for the church. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, while this topic regarding salvation is huge, it's immense and with many wonderful things attached to it, Lord, we ask that you would help us to focus today on this particular passage in the book of Acts 14:24-28, and that we would remember at the same time Acts 1:8. This is most serious. It's a fundamental task of the church that is reaching the lost, and so let us be our passion. Let it be our passion, Lord. I ask too, as a weak man, a sinner yet saved by grace, I need your help. I need your aid. I believe in the ministry of the Holy Spirit. So be it, Lord. Speak well through this weak vessel. We pray it in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Although it often appears to be the opposite in our evangelical context in the West, the salvation of souls is God's work, period. He graces us by using us. And the church is blessed to be included in this wonderful task. It involves warning and offer. Warning and offer. We warn those around us of that which is coming. And we offer the grace of God in Christ Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit through the written word. We present this to the lost. So salvation is God's work, and we're going to expand upon this fact, that is, the salvation of souls is God's work, by asking this question of the text: in what ways is the salvation of souls God's work? In what ways is the salvation of souls God's work? We'll just shorten the question a little bit with the former in mind. In what ways is salvation God's work? Now, the answer to this question is huge, but we're looking at it today with respect to the ministry of the church from the church itself to the world. This is one of those aspects that we must highlight. When we talk about God at work to bring about some of the wonderful things that we see, in particular, salvation of souls, we must address the two points that are observed today in the text. So then let's get to work. In what ways is salvation God's work? Salvation is God's work in that he gives grace. This is the first one of two points. He gives grace, and he does so to the believers. Now, we know the account. The Apostle Paul has been stoned at Lystra, and he, by God's grace, rises up and comes back to work, gets back to work immediately, and Paul and Barnabas attend to the work of the gospel. In verse 22, we touched on this last week, strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in the faith, and saying that through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God. And when they had appointed elders for them in every church with prayer and fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they had believed. And then they passed through. So look at verse 24. And then they, Paul and Barnabas, passed through Syria and came to Pamphylia. And when they had spoken the word in Perga, now we slow down for a moment. You see what's happening here? These people, this Paul, this Barnabas, these apostles, these men of God, they have been beaten. They have been pounded by the world, devil, and flesh. As they are bringing the gospel message, as they bring the truth of Jesus Christ, they're getting nailed. But they keep going. And when they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. They are traveling, and they're presenting the word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. They're not slowing down. And from there, they sailed to Antioch. This would be in Syria, this Antioch. Where they had been commended, this is the important part. It's all important, but this is our focus, sort of the divine comment. Where they had been commended to the grace of God. Let's go back to chapter 13. We look at verses 1 through 3. What does this commending mean? Now there were in the church at Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manane, a member of the court of Herod, the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, note this, while they're worshiping the Lord and fasting, there's a commitment here, the Holy Spirit said, who is a person, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. For the work to which I have called them. Then after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off. So Barnabas and Paul have been commissioned or commended to the grace of God. We will extend that. Come back to the text for today. In verse 26 then, what in the world does it mean to be commended to the grace of God for the work that they had fulfilled? Take the first part of that verse, that section of the verse. Commended means that they were commissioned. The church affirmed the calling of Paul and Barnabas for this particular mission to the Gentiles. And so, mainly. And so off they go. They're commended. But there is more to this. To the grace of God. What does that mean? Well, yeah, they were commissioned by the church, but the church knew it, and Paul and Barnabas knew it, that they were being placed in the hands of God. because ministry outside of the hands of God will fail. Absolutely fail. So they're put into the hands of God, if you like, in a real way. And so they're called to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. And off they go. This trip, by the way, took about 2 years, scholars think. 2 years on the road and 2 years of a lot of pressure and hassle from the world, devil and flesh, but they persisted. As an initial objective, this work was completed. They didn't stop ministry, they just kept on going, but for the initial sending out, after 2 years, they came back and discussed what happened. They were commended, and they were commended to the grace of God. So, continue. It means putting them, in a sense, in the hands of God, trusting the Lord through prayer to move such that their work is complete, even in hard places. It means that God would attend to their work in the first century, in the apostolic era in particular, through the miracles pointing to the message of the gospel, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, people were converted. So what does it mean to commend these people to the grace of God? It means that they're in the hands of God. He will use them to fulfill their work. There's no subcommittee standing in the corner there saying, well, you know, maybe it's time that you move here. We think you should move there and preach the gospel. No, no, no. What this was, the church said, we're now putting you in the hands of God. You're going to go out for as long as it takes to do the initial work to which you have been called. So off you go. And we trust that God will perform what is necessary through the miracles, the ability to speak the gospel clearly, that souls would be saved, and even to protect them from death, because the work isn't done yet. Now, did he protect them from suffering? No. And that's another thing. A weak person like me, I need to get this straight. Because when we interact with our friends and brothers and sisters from around the world, whether they be from China or they be from India, or from our immediate friends in Africa, what do we learn from them? When Reverend Mati came, he showed me the scar on the side of his head. It was a significant scar, and he didn't get that from shaving. He got that from somebody who didn't like him because he was proclaiming the gospel. And so he saw it as a badge of truth because Jesus graced him so that he could be attacked, and then he understood more about what it means to serve Jesus in a very wicked world. So, suffering is a part of it, but God delivered them from death, so grace was abounding to these guys. And that's what it means to turn someone over or put them in the hands of God. It means that they trust that God's grace would abound. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, 8 through 11, one of my favorite passages. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, note this, 8 through 11. Here, Paul speaks to the God of comfort. And this is the second letter to the church at Corinth. Many troubles here. But he wants to tell them the truth because suffering is a part of the believer's life. Verse 8, he talks about the work in Asia. And this is, they're still commended to the grace of God, God's grace abounding. Notice what he writes. We do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. Wait a minute, this is the Apostle Paul. He can't despair of life itself. Yeah, he does, because he is a man trusting in the person of Christ for all things. And we do get to these spots in ministry, by the way. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. Ever feel that? The sentence of death. Because of the persecutions. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. We'll pause there. There is more to say. Let me just say this. God is so gracious that he delivered from death these folks who experienced great suffering, however, and he delivered them because the message must get out. The message of the gospel getting out is more important than my life. It's way more important than my life. Whether I am fully healthy or not is not the issue. The issue is the message getting out? Are we sacrificing to the glory of God and the benefit of many so that Christ might be known, saints built up and Christ might be known in many places? Is that my goal, or is it to protect myself from harm? And the answer is no. It isn't. When you go out to preach the gospel, you're going to get harmed in some sense, in some way. Just know that. If it's true gospel, you're going to get nailed. So what am I saying? God calls his people to service. We do not call ourselves, by the way. And he provides his grace or his favor so that his will might be done. And isn't it great to know that you and I, that we as the body of Christ here in this small place, isn't it great to know that his grace is sufficient? His strength is made perfect in weakness. Isn't that good to know? I am weak. I look at myself in the morning, as I've said before many times, what happened to you, mate? What happened to you? In just 8 hours of sleep or less, you look worse than you did yesterday. Well, and hey, there's a reason for that. It's called the fall. And I don't need to worry about this thing, you know, this declining thing. It doesn't matter. What matters is that the cross is lifted up, and God gives us grace to do that. Here's the application of the text. Pray that we might take our calling to Jesus, to the service of Jesus, seriously, increasingly so, and with confidence increasing. Grace is from God, and it is for us, not against us. He is for us, not against us. And he is so powerful and so loving that he can take people like us, and I'm the weakest, he can take us and turn us loose to the glory of God and use us mightily so souls would come in. Wouldn't it be great if we could have every other week, we could drain the well in Mora of water because we're baptizing so many people. That'd be great. It would be so wonderful, but that comes through the grace of God at work in his people and to his glory. We have the privilege of knowing that because you are giving to the work, for instance, along the Niger River, that hundreds and hundreds of souls already have come to Christ by God's grace, and they're being discipled. Isn't that wonderful? So that's the first thing. In what ways is salvation God's work? Well, God gives grace to people like us. He gives grace. That's his work in the whole ministry of mission evangelism. He's at work. And there are other levels too. We're just going to deal with a couple today. The second thing is, in what ways is salvation God's work, salvation of souls? Well, he not only gives grace, but he opens doors. Notice this. We don't open doors by human strength. Listen to this. Coming back to Acts chapter 14, verse 24 through 26, we paused. For the work they had fulfilled, all the work that they did over the 2 years, they came back. There were souls saved, churches established, elders put into place. Things are starting to look up. The world, devil, and flesh is at war. That's why they have to keep going back. But here they are, they're presenting. Verse 27, when they arrived and gathered the church together, which is what must be done, they declared all that God had done with them. Notice it wasn't. Now just pause for a moment. Here's my slide of me doing everything. No, that's not what it is. This is what God did. God did this. And so here's the presentation. They declared all that God had done with them. They're not exempt. They're a part of it. They are working hard, undergirded by the grace of God. But now notice this next phrase. They declared all that God had done with them and how he, capital H, had opened a door of faith to the Gentiles. Whoa, what confidence. What confidence. When we go out to share the gospel, when we go wherever it is, we're walking around a market, and the brothers and sisters have just, we go out and do a presence evangelism and pray for Muslim, and we're walking through the market, and what do? We just pray and look for opportunities. And what do we do when we do bread handout? Well, we just pray and look for opportunities to share the gospel. What do we do when we're with friends and who do not know Jesus? What do? Well, we look for those doors of opportunity to share the gospel. We had a great meeting at Gideon's on Monday night. Vic Elstrom presented his testimony, and it was a testimony of the work of God at work in his life, moving in, and through the Word of God, through a Gideon Bible, he was converted by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, this is an open door. Doors are being opened. Gideons are just part of it. Missionaries, you're part of this open door ministry of the Lord God. So let's take a look at 1 Corinthians 16:9. 1 Corinthians 16:9, this phrase, open door, let's add some light to it. 1 Corinthians 16:9. Note, we will turn there. Here we go. But I will say, this is these are the plans for travel. The Apostle Paul. Go back to verse 7. I do not want to see you now just in passing. I hope to spend some time with you if the Lord permits. But I will stay in Ephesus until Pentecost, for a wide door for effective work is open to me, and there are many adversaries. Why did he add that? Because there might be an open door, but they're also enemies of the gospel. And they're going to nail you. Oh, well. That's not exactly a poster to put up, but it's true. We'll just save it among ourselves here. Come and do the work of God and get beaten on. 2 Corinthians 2:12. Look at this. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. This, the second epistle, we touched on it earlier. Listen to what Paul writes. When I came to Troas to preach the gospel of Christ, he didn't come there to sit down. He came to stand up. Even though a door was open for me in the Lord, my spirit was not at rest because I did not find my brother Titus there, so I took leave of them and went on to Macedonia. The door is opened, but then there is this, the Apostle Paul recognized that he needed Titus. And so there was this movement going on. God taking him from one place to another. Open door, strife, pressure all the time. Colossians 4:3, we're going to go back to our text after this one. I want you to see this, Colossians 4:3. Here's the text. Verse 2, for context, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Notice the importance of prayer. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the ministry of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. Doors of opportunity are opened by God. They're opened by God so that the church might go through them. But we must be wise. God calls us to do the work of the ministry, but he affords us grace, and through that grace, he opens doors. We don't. We go through them, and we go through them recognizing that trouble can happen. A weak Christian like me, if I go through, if God shows me a door and I want to go through that door, I sense that. If I go thinking that all is going to be well, I'm going to be healthy and wealthy and all that nonsense. I better go preparing to meet at least a 15-rounder. I'd better go prepared to take hits and to keep on moving, because that's what ministry is about. It's not this game playing. We've had it pretty easy here in the West for many years. Not to say there hasn't been good fruit. It sure has been. So blessed by many ministries. But in general, we've come to think that if we minister, then all's going to be well. And all I have to do is get beyond this point of my age, and then I can go off somewhere and play tiddlywinks or something and just brag about what I did. It's whole life, and it can be dangerous. Listen to the rest of this. Come on back with me to Acts chapter 14. So then, let's summarize. They declared all that God had done with them. He goes with us. And how he had opened a door of faith to the Gentiles. And they went through it. Was it easy? No. 2 years. It was delightful, but not easy. And they remained to no little time with the disciples. God showed them where they must go. So, and when they went, disciples were produced, and they needed to be raised up in the Lord. Some of you are going to be disciple makers cum laude. You are going to be disciple makers. All of us are called to evangelism and to assist the new converts, but you're going to be disciple makers with an edge. And some of you are here today, you don't even know it, and I may not know it, but you're going to get called to that front line, making disciples. Just wait. We know that disciples are such by the open doors of God for the church to go through, and that God opens the doors of people's hearts. This is called regeneration. We talked about this before. Don't forget this. We go from open door to disciples, and in between you have the truth of regeneration, because that's what God does as well. God plants a desire in the human heart that otherwise would not be there. We do not choose to be regenerated because we're spiritually dead. Ephesians 2, 1 through 10. We're dead at the bottom of the lake. How can dead people cooperate? Standing at the edge of the water, is a person dead at the bottom of the lake? Are you there? Come up. I want to speak. I want to do CPR on you. You're not moving. That's how ridiculous many of these, some of the evangelistic tools are in the Western world. They're meaningless. No, no, no. God plants a desire in the human heart that otherwise would not be there. Martin Luther was correct in his book, Bondage of the Will. If you've not read it, it's a great volume. Luther wrote this, and he basically said, look, we have freedom of the will. Before regeneration, we're freely to choose wickedness, and we're really good at it. Then regeneration comes. God, the Holy Spirit, and we're free to choose Christ. Faith, repentance, wonderful gifts. So then God, who opens doors of opportunity to present the gospel such that people might be saved and made ready for discipleship, it is God who opens the door of opportunity to present, and he works in hearts to regenerate. That's our God. And we go forward in confidence. We go forward with confidence. I don't know the hearts of people, but God does. And I can go forward with confidence with the gospel at the ready. And you know this, I've said this before. Reverend Dr. Umar Garbadutse taught me so well, take the name of Jesus with you, such that when we see people, we greet them, and doors of opportunity might open, and we tell them about Jesus, the great shepherd. And we tell them of Christ, who suffered, died, and rose up from the dead. He's seated at the right hand of God and is coming back soon. So then, that is what we say as God. It is God who does that door opening. We must watch. So then, what's the application? Pray that God might open doors for our church and individually to reach the lost in our immediate community. All sorts of evil abounding, just weird stuff. And what do we say? Oh, no, I don't want to say to speak to anybody because they might get angry at me. Well, that's inevitable. There are different levels of anger, mind you. So you may want to keep that in mind, too. Some may not be. by the grace of God, they may not be angry, but some may be, and we're just ready for it. And we tell the truth of Jesus in any case. I think it's going to get more and more encouraging and exciting for evangelism. When you're in a hostile environment, some of us were talking about this yesterday, we're in a hostile environment, and you have people sharing the gospel, their life is on the line. And there's something so delightful about that because they realize my life could end right now, but the gospel is more important than life itself. And so they present. So pray that God may open doors for this church and individuals to reach the lost in our immediate community and around the world in ways we haven't talked about yet. So that's it. In what ways is God's salvation God's work? In what ways is salvation of souls God's work? Well, we can talk about many things. He gives grace and he opens doors. There you have it. Confidence builders. Final challenges. And then we will have a song, and then Pastor will close us. Let us turn from anxiety over the fruit of evangelism and trust God, because he's the one who gives the growth. 1 Corinthians 3:6. He's the one who gives the growth. We don't. He does. Also, gather for prayer for the lost. Colossians 4:3 through 4, which we read earlier. In there is this underlying delightful truth of prayer. Pray, pray, pray. That God may open doors of opportunity. Seek his face. And when he does, continue to pray. God, how are we going to do this? What do you want us to do? It? Do we need someone else? Paul needed Titus. Do we need somebody else? What do we need, Lord? Help us. We're weak. We need you, Lord. Turn from anxiety and grow in prayer. So that's why we want to continue to get the evangelism group back together and continue to pray. Special events, you may see many concerts of prayer coming on Saturday nights, just for an hour. And if God wants it to be long, he can extend it. And then we could unite with other churches. We could work it out such that we could bring in Pastor Mati to pray for us through the means of technology, to pray with us and set up one of our meetings to meet with our brothers and sisters overseas. Particularly, let's choose Nigeria. We could choose one of the churches and have Reverend Sadoki, have him be a part of one of our services, etc. There are many ways creative ways that we could bring the church together worldwide and delight in Jesus Christ. Lastly, Acts 4:12. We went through this. Many of you have it memorized in the King James, ESV. Let's take a look at it. And there is salvation. What a wonderful verse. There is. But it's in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And the context says the name is Jesus. So if there is one here today who has never received the Lord Jesus Christ, then you first must be warned, because the wrath of God awaits you unless you repent and trust in Jesus. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray today that that might be so. Turn from a life of sin and self-preservation and put your trust in Jesus Christ, who suffered, died, and rose up from the dead. I'm going to close off with this, because Romans 10 is one of my favorite passages, and I'm going to read it out of the ESV. When we did Navigators Outreach up north in Canada, we would memorize this in the KJV. Here it is in the ESV, Romans chapter 10, verse 8. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is the word of faith that we proclaim in Christ Jesus, that is. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. That's not a, that's the, that Jesus is Lord. There are plenty of lords in the world, you know, sports and money and all manner of things, sexuality, all manner of lords. But there's only one, capital L. And the capital L is appertaining to Jesus. You confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart, the center of your being, all your emotions, all your thoughts, your conscience, the whole deal. For with the heart one believes and is justified, that is declared righteous. We don't have any righteousness of our own. And with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So to you today who have no Jesus, I do not know. The call today is, oh, by the power of the Holy Spirit, might you repent and trust in Jesus. No one else can save. There is no other name. Confucius can't save. Buddha can't save. Allah can't save. Only Jesus. And so flee the wrath to come. And thereby, if you receive Christ by his grace and you're baptized as you saw Jim being baptized today, you will declare to the world, I am saved. And on the day when Jesus comes, you'll be gathered to him and you will experience life eternal in the new heaven and the new earth. Isn't that great? Nothing compares to it. That's enough, Pastor.
Hymn together, take up your hymnals, and you could stand with us, and we'll sing together number 63, number 63.
Jesus, what a friend for sinners, Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me, he, my Savior, makes me whole. Hallelujah, what a Savior, hallelujah, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end. Jesus, what a strength in weakness, let me hide myself in him. Tempted, tried, and sometimes failing, he, my strength, my victory wins. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end. Jesus, what a help in sorrow, while the billows o'er me roll. Even when my heart is breaking, he, my comfort, helps my soul. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a friend. Saving, helping, he is with me to the end. Jesus, what a guide and keeper, while the tempest still is high. Storms about me night or day. me, he my pilot hears my cry. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end. Jesus, I do now receive him, more than all in him I find. He hath granted me forgiveness. I am his and he is mine. Alleluia, what a Savior. Alleluia, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, he is with me to the end.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are with us to the end through Jesus, that you give us what we need, you give us the strength we need, and we pray that you would strengthen us and make us bold in telling the truth to those round about us, that you would help us to know that it will not be easy and that we will face trouble through it, but we are Christ's. And that gives us boldness. We have your Spirit, and you do the work of salvation. So help us to be praying. Help us to be speaking. Help us to be loving and reaching out. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.